Nice job, Francis, and good morning, choir.
Good morning.
And good morning to all of you this morning, and welcome to Grace Presbyterian Church. And to all our neighbors who are around us this morning, we welcome them as well. And we're hoping that all of you are having a great summer, maybe not having a COVID. I know the COVID's been coming back again, and a lot of my family and friends we know have been coming down with it as well. So we ask for prayers for them as well. And we also say, if you'd like to join us at halftime for some refreshments and fellowship, we'd love to have you and join us with some nice, good fellowship as well. I just want to remind everyone, on July 20th, because of vacations and all, our office is going to be closed on the 20th and the 25th and the 26th and the 27th. So it's much needed. These people work hard all year round. They need to get away and get regenerated again. So if you do need some help or emergency, you can get a hold of Pastor Mike. He'll be happy to take care of you. Did I do that, Gail? My Pastor Mike? Okay. All right. So there's a person here I wanted to talk to, but I don't see her yet. So at this time, if you wouldn't mind standing up and greeting each other, we'd love to have you. Hi, Stephen. Good morning. Hey, Steve.
Hey, thank you.
Hey, good morning. My name is Susan Hiltbrand. I just want to announce it. We do a Bible study on Thursday mornings at 10 a.m. at the church, and we're going to be starting a new one in a couple weeks on 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, and we'd love to have any of you who'd like to join us. If you're interested, please see me after the service or give me a call. My number's in the church directory. Thank you.
Thank you, Sue. We just have all types of information this morning, don't we, huh? We have something special this morning. Uh-oh. There she goes again. My wife's going to do a solo this morning. Just kidding. She's going to kill me when I get home today, but that's okay. I've been killed many times. At this time, I'd like to welcome Jane Compton, come on up here, my dear. Yeah, you, I'm talking about you. Yeah, I know. Well, you gave it to me all the time.
Well, it seemed like I walked in. I'm like, now the service can start.
You know, Jane Compton's starting a new chapter in her life, and I've known her for many, many years. She's been a member of this church for over 30.
No, don't you start.
No, I'm not starting anything. Over 30 years, and so she's worn many, many hats at this church, deacons, the calling of our congregation, and helping in the kitchen, and helping in the food distribution with Stephen and us, all of us. So you've done a lot, and we appreciate all. Huh?
I have.
I know you have. And Mark was a great gentleman, too, and a good Marine, and We lost him a few years ago, but they did a lot for this church, and we really appreciate what all the Comptons have done in this church. And we picked those especially for you this morning. I hope they're nice and fresh. But why don't you tell us a little bit about your journey, and where you're going, and anything else you'd like to talk about?
Well, we started coming to the church in 1990, right before Mark deployed to Desert Storm, and we had both been raised Methodist, and we visited all the Methodist churches in this area as a young military couple when we came to the area, and we didn't like any of them. People were not welcoming, people did not greet us, that kind of thing, and my wise grandmother said, well, and she was a diehard Methodist from the time she was born till the time she died, at 93 years old in Iowa, and she said, well, you need to be going to church. You're a young couple. And she said, if you can't find a Methodist church you like, you should check out Presbyterian. So hence, we started doing that, and as all of us have probably said over the years, and even the newer people, it's the people that brought us all here. It's the welcoming spirit of this church, which has kept going through the highs and the lows, and that has been the endearing thing. I've been a deacon, as was mentioned, for many years. I've seen many, I've participated in many, funeral services. So many people we lost over the years, and been through now 2.5 pastors. And because when we started coming, for those that were here, like the Campbells, we still had Pastor Chambers. And then Tom Strader was here for 21 years. And now I think Mike and Joni are going to be here another 21 or so. And anyway, I am moving north. I'm staying in California. And I'm moving north to the town of Sonoma in wine country. It is not Sonora. And it is not Sedona. I've heard that from numerous people. No, it is Sonoma in the heart of wine country, twin town to Napa. And my oldest sister has lived there for 23 years, and then our 89-year-old mother said, I'm going to have an adventure, and packed up her stuff and moved to Sonoma from Minnesota, where she spent her entire life. And she is still very healthy, and I want to go and be with her and spend time with her and have adventures with her. And there's a great Presbyterian church up there called St. Andrews, which is where I will probably find my next Presbyterian home, so... Anyway, it's been a pleasure to be of service here. As has been said, there's been a lot of wonderful things that have gone on in this ministry and continues to go on. So it'll be interesting from afar to see what continues to transpire here. So my heart is heavy, and it's bittersweet, but I'm excited as well. So the movers come tomorrow. I sold my house in May. Escrow closed the first part of June, and I've been renting back. And movers come tomorrow, and then my other sister Betsy is here from Minnesota to help me with the final push, and then we will probably be leaving to drive up there Tuesday afternoon. So thank you.
Let's, I just got to say, you've been an amazing servant in the 5 years that I've been here, and I've just enjoyed, yeah, I know.
Well, I know you came right before Mark got sick.
Yeah.
It's not 2 years anymore.
I know. But, it's just been really wonderful to have a partnership with you and the rest of the congregation, but you've been really special, and we're going to miss you. So let's pray for Jean and her adventures ahead. If you want, raise a hand toward her, and we'll just bless her. Lord God, thank you that you've created us for amazing things, and you have shown those amazing things through Jean, and we know, Lord, that you have amazing and wonderful workmanship ahead for her. You've got plans, not to harm, but to give her so much more in a relationship with you and through her to others. And Lord, we pray a special blessing upon her, safe travels and transitions, but also as she makes her new home and discovers with new adventures, Lord, we pray that you would just bless her with incredible friendships and a church like this one. full of love and caring, and a place where she can continue to serve you. And we pray this in Jesus' name, and all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Thank you. God bless.
Morning. This morning's call to worship comes from Psalm 146. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will sing praises of God all my life long. Happy are those whose help is in God, creator of heaven and earth, who is faithful forever, seeking the justice for the oppressed and for the hungry, setting prisoners free, and opening the eyes of the blind, lifting up those who are bowed down, and loving the righteous. The Lord protects strangers and upholds the orphan and widow, but the way of the wicked is brought to ruin. The Lord our God will reign forever, for all generations. Praise the Lord. Join me in prayer. We praise you, O God, for being not only the God of history, but the God of our story. You have gathered us here today to remind us that although you are the one to whom all the power belongs, you care for the weak and powerless. You care for us. We praise you for joining your story with ours in such a special way through Jesus, our Lord. He proved his great love to you and for each of us in the way he lived, releasing what it was captive, lifting up the burden, empowering the powerless. God, source of loving kindness and strength, we worship you. Jesus, foundation of our faith, we worship you. Holy Spirit, ground in our very being, we worship you. May our hour of praise and worship be pleasing to you. Amen.
Let's stand together and sing our opening hymn called Praise the Lord the Almighty.
Praise the Lord, the Almighty.
Please be seated. We're a little short today in the praise band for good reasons. Grandma had to be at her grandson's all-star game. They're playing for the regional championship today. So be sure and check with Diane later to see how things went. But
we and get Annabelle is laying low. She's had a lot of exposure to COVID, and she's trying to stay healthy before going back to Indiana in a couple weeks. So we may not see her for a little bit.
Yeah, a little bit.
So you get the dudes.
But we still praise the Lord, right? So we have this wonderful little song called The Stand this morning for you.
What can I say?
So what can I say?
What can I say?
What can I do?
What can I do?
But offer this heart, O God, completely to you. Please be seated. So much to be thankful for, isn't there? We have an incredible day to enjoy here in Southern California, a beautiful day to enjoy the summer, and a beautiful time to be together in the light of the Holy Spirit, in the warmth of the Spirit among us. This is a very special worship service for us today. Every day is a special day to worship our Lord. Let us be grateful. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day that you've given to us to use for your purposes, to enjoy your presence, to learn from you, to worship you, to praise you, to serve you. We pray, oh God, thanksgivings for all that you give us, your good and perfect gifts. And all God's people said, amen. It's great to have the choir back.
Yeah.
Well, not all of them were gone, but it's good to see you all. And that was a great, wonderful anthem. Thank you very much. Well, I forgot to bring my Dodger cap because they're doing so well. Kershaw almost had a perfect game the other night. Isn't that amazing? Going into the eighth, unfortunately. That was Dash, but he's back, and we're headed into the All-Star break, and guess where it is? At Dodger Stadium, of course, right. So I thought, because it's midsummer and it's coming up on the All-Star break, I'd give you a little story about God's baseball team. So I read this parable about a baseball game where the Lord's team was playing Satan's team. And the Lord's team was at bat. And the score was 0-0 going into the ninth inning. with two outs. The coach and the Lord watched as the batter stepped up to the plate, whose name was Love. Love swung at the first pitch and hit a single because love never fails. Right? Well, the next batter was Faith, and also he got a single because faith works with love. And the Lord then turned to the coach and told him that he was now going to bring in his star player. Oh, I forgot. The next batter was the Godly Wisdom, and Satan threw a ball, four balls at Godly Wisdom because Godly Wisdom never swings at what Satan throws, right? So bases are loaded, and then the Lord sends up his star player. And this was, his name was Grace, but Grace didn't look very strong. He looked kind of wimpy and small, and Satan and his whole team decided to relax a bit. Oh, we got this. This guy's not going to be able to hit anything. We're going to get this last out. Well, Grace hit the ball harder than anyone had ever expected over the fence for a home run. Because if your love, faith, and wisdom had won the game, well, I'm skipping ahead here again. the Lord's team won. The Lord then explained to his coach that love, faith, and godly wisdom could get on base, but they couldn't win the game. It was only by his grace that they could win and get everyone home. Well, you know, 2 weeks ago I started a series on the book of Galatians. And I taught on the first chapter with the Apostle Paul, who began with the calling of the churches in Galatia, that region in modern-day Turkey, back to the gospel freedoms that he had taught to them when he had gone on his missionary journey throughout that region. And they had been invaded by Judaizers, which were Jewish Christians who were calling these churches not only to receive the grace of God in Jesus Christ, but to add on to that for their salvation the laws of Moses. So there was a works-oriented salvation that Christians are set free from through the grace of God. And so Paul was trying to correct their theology and bring them back to the truth, because grace is the source of our salvation in Christ. So today, I want to also look at justification through faith, which is the means of our salvation. So in the first part of Galatians chapter 2, Paul talks about a personal experience that he had with those who would add on to the gospel message of justification through faith, where he went to Jerusalem and he met with the apostles and those who were there, and Peter, who was starting to lean into that particular works-oriented salvation. And so you can read about all that in Acts chapter 15, that salvation came only through God's grace, according to what Paul understood, and not with the addition of obeying Jewish laws. And that's where we pick up the text this morning in Galatians chapter 2, verse 15 through verse 21. So let's pray while you're turning to that. Lord God, thank you for your message of grace, but also thank you for helping us to understand what it means to be righteous, to receive Christ's righteousness in us, your justification through faith. And so, Lord, we pray your blessing upon this message and this teaching. Hide it in our hearts so that we can live for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So hear the word of God. We who are Jews, by birth and not Gentile sinners, know that a person is not justified by observing the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. So we, too, have put our faith in Christ Jesus, that we may be justified by faith in Christ Jesus, and not by observing the law, because by observing the law, no one will be justified. If while we seek to be justified in Christ, it becomes evident that we ourselves are sinners, does that mean that Christ promotes sin? Absolutely not. If I rebuild what I destroyed, I prove that I am a lawbreaker. For through the law, I died to the law so that I might live for God. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for righteousness could be gained through the law. Christ died for nothing. May God bless to us an understanding of his word. By the way, I got to thank Pastor John Mosier for coming and being with you last week. Wasn't he amazing? Good teacher, funny guy too, isn't he? I love John dearly. He's been a good friend for probably 35 years, and our paths have crossed so many times, and we're so grateful to have people like him in our presbytery that we can call on for times like this. Incidentally, our General Assembly met, and I was a commissioner, and we did all kinds of things. I'd be glad to answer any of your questions that you might have from some of the decisions that were made at the General Assembly. There was a lot of good things, but there was a lot of controversial things, too. So if you have any questions, just, you know, give me a call or meet with me. I'd be glad to sit down and talk about it. Well, Paul wants his readers to understand that if they consider the law of Moses, like the Ten Commandments and all of the other commands that come along with that through the centuries, as a basis of their justification with God, it will be in vain. The law was set up to help people see that they were indeed sinners, broken. And the law continues to remind us of our brokenness and where we fall short of God's best for us. There's no one except Christ himself who has ever or will ever live a sinless life. God's law helps us to see that we can't live without breaking the law. And so that is kind of like viewing a diamond with a black velvet pad underneath it so you can see all the flaws and facets that a diamond has. The law does that for us. It helps us to see where we're broken, where we need God's grace. Well, the Jewish understanding of the law was that if one were to live a life in compliance to the law, then one could have a right relationship with God. Paul had come to the knowledge that becoming righteous through what we do doesn't get one into heaven, but being made right by God does justify us into his salvation. That's why he states in verses 15 and 16 these words. We who are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners know that a man is not justified by observing the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. Now, our present understanding of law is different than that of the Jews in the first century. The function of modern law is to govern relationships between persons and institutions, making sure that they are righteous and just. However, the Jews thought that obedience to the law rendered one in right relationship with God, therefore with others. The object of obedience was to justify oneself to God to be accepted by him. In other words, the law of the state and the law of God were one and the same. The purpose of obedience was to make one worthy of living in the God in the chosen nation. Therefore, when Jews became Christians, it was very hard for them to separate justification from the law, imposing the law on Gentile Christians. So justification is a legal transaction. However, God declares a condemned sinner not guilty because the penalty for his sin has been paid by the substitute, and that substitute is Jesus Christ. Our sin was credited to Christ, and his perfect righteousness was credited to us. So the issue of a bad record is dealt with in a legal sense when it comes to our brokenness and how we are received by God's love and grace through Christ. Now, I find that even in the church today, we tend to impose the law on people before they come to Christ. For example, where do non-Christians get the idea that they must get their act together before coming to church or becoming a Christian? Somehow we subtly send this message that people need to change their lives to reflect good and righteous behavior before they can be received into the church and salvation in Christ. Well, this message is picked up within our general culture as well. If you watch films from Hollywood, you'll understand that this message, too, is in most movies where religious things are dealt with. Being a good person is the message that gets you into heaven that comes through Hollywood's movies. Now, this is thought to be a minimal entrance requirement into heaven by the general public. However, if we read the New Testament with integrity, we see clearly that being good is not good enough. Obeying the law is not good enough. Our salvation is dependent upon what God has done for us, not what we can do for ourselves. The false teaching, thinking that we could be good enough on our own merits, is the religion of the person on the street. In fact, it is the fundamental principle of every religious and moral system in the world, except biblical Christianity. Scholar John Stott wrote this: It is popular because it is flattering. It tells a man that if he will only pull his socks up a bit higher and try a bit harder, he will succeed in winning his own salvation. Well, of course, it is all a delusion if you take that track. Nobody has ever or ever will be justified by observing the law. And why is that? Because nobody has ever kept the law perfectly. Observing the law, perfect obedience to its demands, is beyond every one of us. Only Jesus Christ has kept the law perfectly in every way. You ever tried to live one day, or let's just 1 minute, without some sinful thought that comes to your head, or not being as sensitive as you needed to be, or empathetic or kind? You get my point. Only Jesus has kept the law perfectly. Scripture is clear on that. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That sin destroys us if it's left to ourselves. For the wages of sin is death. But, and here's the justification part, the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Now that's good news, isn't it? Scripture is clear that in Jesus Christ we are saved from our sin by faith. Justification is the legal term that declares us innocent before God. Our penalty is paid by Christ on the cross, and we receive the status, just if I'd never sinned. A little play on words. Just if I'd never sinned. We are confronted with Scripture, are comforted with Scripture such as Romans 10, verses 9 and 10. Look at these words. That if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified. And it is with your mouth that you confess and are saved. Love that scripture. Now, here is the core of Paul's teaching. He opposed all forms of works justification. And we are made right before God by what we do, is what works justification is all about. We're sinners who have transgressed the will of God, and there's nothing we can do to make things right. Paul teaches that it is entirely up to God to make things right. He is the forgiver of our sins in Christ our Lord. He is the cleanser of our souls from the stain of sin. He is the initiator of our salvation, and he is also the one who acquits us because the debt is paid by Christ.
To be justified means that we are acquitted, accepted, set right with God, saved despite ourselves. Now, scholar Maxie Dunnan writes this. He says, "What a strange turn of mind in the Jewish system. A God who justifies the ungodly, not the godly? Don't miss the importance of this. If God justified the godly, we could calculate and even control our justification because we would have an achievement award system. Such a system can be manipulated. So justification would really be in our hands." Paul says, this can't be so. A man is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. Now, I've repeated that and looked at it from different angles because it's so important that we get this. Salvation is offered by God through grace, but it is our faith that takes the risk of acceptance. Salvation faith is that kind of faith that actively trusts God to be to the point of throwing ourselves at the mercy of God, throwing ourselves down at the foot of the cross in faith that what God says is true. And when we have done that, and those of us that have, we know it's true. We've experienced God's freedom in our hearts and our minds. We've experienced a transformation of our very nature. We've completely gave ourselves our parents, you might recall, when you were really little, you trusted them implicitly. There was nothing that they could do wrong. Remember those days as little toddlers? And when they were gone, when they were gone, we felt a little afraid, a little unsure. But when they were with us, nothing could harm us, right? We trusted them. And that's the way it is in our relationship with God. We can place ourselves in his control and know that he has got our back and he walks with us through all things, that our lives don't have to remain the same, that we can be transformed to be more like Christ. Well, the same is certainly true in our relationship with God. God justifies us to himself through faith in Christ and to trust in Christ, to put our faith in him is our justification. However, there are some who might misinterpret the application of God's salvation in Christ. And so Paul brings that up in verse 17. He says, "If while we seek to be justified in Christ, it becomes evident that we ourselves are sinners, does that mean that Christ promotes sin?" And he answers, "Absolutely not." The force of that is more like, "Hell no," in the Greek. Seriously, hell, no. Paul points out a danger here in verse 17. Paul's critics said that justification by faith without observing the law promotes sin. Paul vehemently denies this, and Christ is never the author of sin. The danger for people in knowing God's grace is to think that they can live a life without a life of sin without worry because their sins are now forgiven in Christ. But that would be cheap grace. It's a heresy of the early church called Antinomianism. So we ask ourselves, how can grace be so cheap where all that I need is to believe? The answer is grace is not cheap. It cost God dearly, his son, on the cross. In our place, that we might be forgiven and have eternal life. And then our life here on this earth can be different, transformed, sanctified, full of God's righteousness. We're forgiven of our sins, but we also have a new master. We've traded in the old master for Christ to be master over us. Paul wrote in verse 19, "For through the law, I died to the law so that I might live for God." It then becomes our desire to live as Christ lives, to honor God in all that we do in response to his mercy
for us. Well, Paul understood this tension in the Christian life. Paul explains it in chapter 7 of Romans. Why do I do the things that I don't want to do, and I don't do the things that I do want to do? Thanks be to God, you know, for Jesus in our lives. And so Paul writes here in our text this morning, in verse 20 and 21, he writes, I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for its righteousness could be gained through the law. For if righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing. So how do I overcome this tendency in my life to do the things I don't want to do? How do I overcome my brokenness? It's by recognizing and that Christ is living within us, that we have a source within us to change us, to be different, to not be the same person we were before Christ entered in. Or even yesterday, we can improve each and every day. It's an ongoing thing. Joni and I were talking about, wow, sanctification. You know, till we get to Jesus, it won't be perfect. You know, we won't be completely sanctified till that day when we are standing with him. But we're headed in the right direction, aren't we? As God reveals things in us and as he wants to change us and we allow him to take those broken pieces and knit them back together in righteousness. When we are crucified with Christ, we are not only forgiven our sins, but we have been transformed to desire and to resist sin. Because we're laying down our lives and taking them up at the life of Christ on the cross, we give ourselves a new reality. And that reality is not seeking after our own goals, but seeking to live as Christ and to meet his goals. This desire is not sin. To not sin is accompanied with the strength to not sin. When our will becomes the will of Christ because our old self has been crucified on the cross, then we are strengthened to resist sin. And once we have been united in Christ in his death and resurrection, our old life is finished. It's foolish to suggest that we could ever go back to it. We have risen to a new life in Christ. Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. It's gone. The new has come. There is an example of a life transformed by God's grace, a life that shares in suffering and death and resurrection of Christ. There's a Russian, Ukrainian philosopher, theologian, Berdeyev, I think is his last name. Did I get that right, Elena? Berdeyev? Yeah, maybe. who abandoned Marxism for Christianity. And he insisted that neither history nor theology nor church brought him to Christian faith, but a simple woman known only to him as Mother Maria. He was present at a concentration camp when the Nazis were murdering Jews in the gas chambers. One distraught mother refused to part with her baby. When Maria saw that the officer was only interested in numbers, without a word, she pushed the mother aside and quickly took her place. This action revealed to Berdeyev the heart of Christianity. Like Paul, Mother Maria was crucified with Christ. And it was not she who lived for herself, but Christ who lived in her. Now, you and I may never be called literally to give up our lives as martyr for our faith, but we are called on by God to die to self so that Christ can live within us. Our challenge today is to examine our attitudes and our lifestyles and to see if there's anything that we haven't hasn't been crucified with Christ on the cross that we have, through faith, acknowledged. Are we holding on to some sin and giving it permission to remain in our lives that we want to get rid of? Let's go to the cross once again. Receive God's strength to resist and to be transformed. These things are more, these things and more must be replaced by Christ who lives in us. So I want to give you a little summary that I found that scholar J.I. Packer gives us. He calls it the Reformer's Exposition of Justification. And it all boils down to these 7 points. And if you'd like a copy of that, you can go online, of course, and see it. But I'd be glad to give it to you. The first one is, every person faces the judgment seat of God and must answer to God for himself. The church cannot shield him from this. The second one is, every person is a sinner by nature and practice, a nonconformist so far as God's law is concerned, and therefore can only expect God's wrath and rejection. Third one is, justification is God's judicial act of pardoning the guilty sinner and accepting him righteous and receiving him as a son. The fourth one is, the source of justification is grace, not human effort or initiative. And the fifth, the ground of justification is Christ's vicarious righteousness and blood shedding, not our own merit. Sixth, the means of justification here and now is faith in Jesus Christ. And seventh, the fruit of faith, the evidence of its reality, is manifested repentance and a life of good works. So you see, good works comes because of God's influence on our lives, because of his grace and mercy, because of his righteousness that has been credited to us. Today is the day that God's grace hits a home run of salvation for those who would yield themselves to Christ and his ministry of the cross. He has done everything in his power to make a relationship with God possible for each of us. He's given us the way, the only way, to be justified before God unto eternal life. So don't let another day go by that you don't accept this grace of God through faith. The gift that is set for you to set you free. You don't have to be bound by any religious rules anymore. You only have to step out in faith and receive God's gift. The only thing that God requires of you is to exercise faith in Jesus Christ, receiving this gift of salvation. He has already done the rest to justify a relationship based on his love for us and not on our merits. God's not going to force you to receive his love. It's yours for the asking in faith. So today, let God save you into eternal relationship with him. Today, let the new life of Christ's resurrection guide you into a life of good works. Paul wrote in Ephesians 2, verse 10, these words, "For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." This is the result of our justification through faith. A transformed life becomes an instrument of transformation throughout the world. Amen?
Amen.
So as we enter into our prayer time, we haven't done this for a little while, but I would invite several of you to pray out loud for your particular prayer needs or the needs of others, intercede on their behalf. But keep in mind, there is so much brokenness in our world. We've got the continued war in Ukraine. We've got COVID moving fast around the world and people in danger of that. We have the PNC needs our prayers as they continue the process of working towards the next pastor of this congregation. And there's just a lot of things
People are struggling with illnesses of various kinds. So let's lift up these words of intercession to our Lord. Heavenly Father, we come before you to honor you and to glorify you and to thank you for this message that we just received, this teaching about justification. You've done all the work for us. All we need now, Lord, is faith. Faith to receive, each day to receive your righteousness into our lives. Thank you that Christ lives in us, that we are dead to sin, that we are alive in Christ. So, Lord, hear our prayers as we lift them up to you. We lift up Weston to you, O Lord. Lord, we lift up Heather's dad, struggling with COVID, and we lift up her son Cameron to you and ask that you would be with him and help stabilize him and bring him home. God's Father, Ed, and Lord, we ask for continued healing and recovery and being with him, and thank you, Lord, that he's home. Bailey and Shana and this little girl, Lord. Yes, Lord, be with Kim's friend and help her out. Deliver her. Help her through rehab. Lord, we lift up just all of these prayers, and even the ones that are not spoken. We know you hear each one of them, whether they're coming out of our heart or out of our mouth. And we pray, Lord, your blessing upon this world, and we pray for peace in this world, that you would unite this nation again that is so divided, and that you would bring peace in Europe between the Russians and the Ukrainians. And we pray, Lord, for a ceasefire and a treaty and an end to the hostilities and violence that is going on there that is just horrible and terrible. And we pray, Lord, for protection for those who are experiencing floods and fires and tornadoes and all kinds of weather disasters right now. We pray, God, that you would watch over them and help them to recover if they've had loss. And we remember the prayer that you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sinned against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's stand together and sing a hymn called My Faith Looks Up to Thee. Let's remain standing and sing this song. It's a fun celebrative song about trusting the Lord. This one's for you, Gene. we know you like these upbeat and celebrative songs. So let's affirm our faith and trust in Jesus.
Strong mountain, they will not.
They will not.
God like Mount Zion.
Accident today. This is, God had just us to be here together to worship Him, to hear His word, to lift praises and sing these songs. You have been blessed by the Lord.
Amen.
Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore.